Hello and welcome back at MAHLE at the IAA Mobility 2021 here at the open space at Munich Königsplatz. My name is Lisa Hofmann and I'm your host for the MAHLE Mobility Talks here at the IAA. And today's topic is going to be performance and emotion, motorsport as an innovative accelerator. Therefore, I've got two experts by my side and I want to introduce them to you. First one is Mark Preston. He's the team principal of DS-Techeetah. Mark, nice to have you here. How are you doing?
Thank you. Very good to be here. It's exciting to come and talk about the future.
We're having a Formula E car here at our booth. How does it feel for you to have a DS-Techeetah car at the IAA?
It's great. Knowing I've been here to the IAA before, and it's great to have the car here to show off the technology and the future and our partnership with MAHLE. It's really good.
My second expert is from MAHLE, and his name is Fred Türk. Fred, nice to have you here. You're the Vice President Motorsports and Special Applications. How are you doing today?
Excellent. I'm glad to be here at that exciting show, and it's nice to talk to you and to Mark, obviously.
How do you like the booth with the Formula E car?
Fantastic. It's so well done. It's really, really great.
So we've already talked about that car. Let's just talk about the Formula E season because it just finished a few weeks ago in Berlin and both of your drivers finished in the top 10. I guess you've seen a lot of highlights in this season. What was the greatest one?
Yeah, the best one for me this year was winning Monaco because Monaco's Monaco, and having been in F1 before and those sort of things, it's really nice to be in Monaco and get that the trophy on the podium there in with the prince and everything. So that was the best fun this year, I thought.
But why do you say Monaco? Because you also won in Rome.
Yeah, well, the overtaking of Antonio, the way he did it, the way he overtook on the last lap, was made the whole thing probably one of the more exciting Formula E races, and probably one of the more exciting races, I would say, in Monaco ever. It's going to go down in history, I think.
And there was this amazing pool jump at the end, so yeah. Everybody can recognize that. So when you look back at the whole season, what was special about that one in this year?
This season was really interesting because it was the first time we were a world championship, so that sort of shows that in the world's eyes that Formula E's grown up and become equivalent to many of the other championships that the FIA runs. So becoming a world championship was important. A lot of big and hard competition this year from a lot of competitors. Some of our competitors are here today, we can see. But yeah, it was really, really hot competition and very close this year.
Fred, MAHLE is also involved into motorsports. Can you explain why and how?
Of course. So, I think motorsport is part of MAHLE's DNA since the company was founded 100 years ago. And the challenges in motorsport are leading to innovative technical solutions. And Formula E, for us, is a perfect platform to promote our dual strategy. And behind our dual strategy is that we are convinced that internal combustion engines will be needed far longer than it's today's expectations. And therefore, we need to continue to develop these engines in order to make them more efficient. And that's one of our big tasks. The other task is to develop the e-mobility, which is as well very important, but in areas where it makes sense. This is the key message in my personal view for the e-mobility.
Sure, interesting aspect. So, Mark, in Formula E, the races are always very exciting, and it's not possible to predict who's going to be the favorite for the victory. Why is it that exciting, always?
So it's, I suppose, it's deliberate by design, the way that the qualifying system is set up. So if you're leading the championship, you go out and basically clean the track for everybody else, which means that it's very hard if you're winning the championship to go quickly in qualifying. But what that does do is it makes the races more crazy, because then potentially the fastest guys who are winning the championship are maybe at the back of the grid sometimes, maybe at the front of the grid sometimes, and that causes lots of chaos, because if you're at the back of the grid, then you've got to go through the pack to win. You probably saw that it didn't work out quite well for us in London, where Antonio was leading or very close to the top of the championship, and he qualified at the back. And then as he came through the pack, he eventually got taken out by one of the competitors because he had to be so strong and aggressive in his racing. So that's probably one of the key points. The other one is that's interesting in electric racing is that everyone has the same peak power, so the same peak. Whereas in an internal combustion engine that Fred was talking about a minute ago, you can take a certain amount of fuel and make more power if you can. In Formula E, it's capped. And so one of the more important parameters, getting technical about it, is the same across all cars. So that keeps it close together and exciting.
So could you just sum it up? What distinguishes motorsports in Formula E from other series?
So what does... comes from other series, you mean, or what's different to other series?
I want to know what's different.
So yeah, the difference is that the peak power, so the amount of power we can use in the powertrain. So at the moment in qualifying it's 250 kilowatts, and then in the future when we go on to the generation 3 there'll be more power in a few more years. So it's the peak power that's quite different than other series.
And are there some special challenges in Formula E compared to other series?
Yeah, so the drivers have to save roughly 30% of energy during the race. So that's but you can do that in your electric car as well. So there's a lot of parallels between a race car and what you can do in your electric car. So every time they come in to brake in a corner, first they take energy into the battery, and then they use the real brakes, or the what we call maybe the old-fashioned brakes, when you get into the middle of the corner. So they have to save about 30% of energy, which is quite a job, as well as race at the same time.
We just have that in Formula E, so that's totally new. That's right. Fried, let's just talk about that topic from the company's view. So what does MAHLE do for motorsports?
MAHLE Motorsport is developing and producing quite big range of engine components for internal combustion engines. And for the electric drives, we are focusing on thermal management.
So, but what can be learned in motorsports for the daily car?
Yeah, as mentioned earlier, we are continuously doing innovations, and the lessons learned out of motor racing, you could call it a fast test lab, are transferred to the serial products. And as a consequence, or as a result, you see, for example, in your car, less fuel consumption, less emissions, or extended range on battery electric cars or hybrids. So it's a direct transfer from lessons learned from motorsports to the road cars.
We are just talking about motorsports in general, but MAHLE is active in Formula One and in Formula E. So what distinguishes the work behind in both series?
So Formula E is basically a continuous development loop, pushing mechanical components to its limit, striving for higher performance and efficiency. Given by the restrictions of regulations, Formula E is a more, I would say, driver-orientated formula, managing the given energy.
Yeah, what and Mark said, yeah.
Exactly. And so the working environment and the development speed is quite different from Formula One to Formula E.
Yeah, that's interesting, actually. So let's just go back on track, Mark. We've had 15 races in this year in 8 different countries and therefore 8 different cities. But because we are having city tracks, it's really difficult to prepare. So how are you preparing before a race?
Yeah, so the drivers spend time in the simulator. So we have a simulator at the factory in Paris. And so they spend a number of days before the race preparing, practicing, running through all the scenarios, what could happen. And so by preparing the scenarios, if something happens in the race, hopefully they know, that happened in the simulator, I'll be able to do what I tried there. They have to practice how to save the energy, so they experiment with how to save the energy the best in the best places. Sometimes the simulation will say, you should do it here, but maybe in the simulator, the driver says, well, that's a bit difficult for me as a driver to do it there, so let's change it to over here in a different corner. So they work through all of the scenarios before we go to the racetrack.
Do you have a simulator at the track as well?
No, we don't have a simulator at the track because one of the reasons is because we race on one day. So we arrive in the morning and there's not really any time to do anything, which is another thing that's different to actually to other motor racing, which spreads out over 3 days, the drivers have got to go in the morning, arrive, not crash, not have any problems, because if you do that, you're probably not going to be successful during the day. So everything's got to go right, and it's a really fast-paced day. So starting very early, like 5 in the morning, leaving the hotel, and then, you know, finishing at the end of the race at 5 o'clock at night. So
That's so much work, actually. Yeah. But how can we imagine a practice session at home in the simulator? How many hours are they driving without a break? Are both of the drivers there? How can we imagine?
Yeah, so they spend maybe 2 to 3 days at the simulator. They'll swap in and out, taking turns. We've also got development driver James Rossiter, who's also developing because he's got an incredible amount of experience from F1 and other racing series. So between the three drivers, plus we also have a simulator driver that also races for MAHLE as well in esports. So there's four sort of total drivers that do work on it. So the development drivers will get everything ready, and then when the main drivers come, that they go through the aspects of the preparation. So you can probably follow along with the simulator as well at home and learn quite a lot about what goes on in the races.
So, but to get more into detail, what can be simulated?
So we have the full simulation of the car, the electronics, all the mechanical systems that Fred was talking about. Everything's as close to the real world as possible, so that anything that goes wrong on the simulator is probably the same as on the racetrack. So we have the real ECUs, the real parts of the car are often included in the simulator, so that we get the real feedback of what happens. So it's testing, looks like a test center for preparing a road car. It's a fast-paced testing of the race cars and the drivers.
So the drivers prepare in the simulator and then they come to the racetrack.
Yep.
But I guess there are some differences. So what about, for example, cracks in the asphalt? Can they be simulated?
Yeah, there was actually we went to Puebla, there was some water coming out of the asphalt in Puebla, and that wasn't in the simulator, as you say. So they had a few spins when they got to the track finding the actual differences. But that's what makes some of the best drivers, who can take... They know what the simulator is good at, but they know when they arrive at the track, okay, this is the difference between the simulator and the track. I've got that correlated in my head on the simulator when we expected this might be the case. So we did these things in the simulator, try them on the track. Yeah, they work. Okay, we'll go that direction. So the drivers are very important to go between when we actually arrive and linking their knowledge back to what they learned on the simulator.
So they need to adapt very quickly, right?
Yes, yes.
And therefore you're going to have a track walk. Does it help?
Yeah, so then we go around the track and look at things like this water that we were saying in Puebla that didn't completely help, checking out which things look a little bit different, because there is always some difference, especially in Formula E, because the tracks are actually built on the Friday night or the days leading up to the race, and if there's a small modification they have to make, then that won't be the same as the simulator. So yes, have to go around and say that doesn't look like the simulator, we need to make a few changes in our heads for the first practice session.
So we've talked about the adaptation of the drivers now, but Fred, I think MAHLE also had to adapt over the last 100 years because they had to develop. Can you just explain the progress?
Yeah, MAHLE has a very long and I think a very successful history in motor racing, with activities in Formula One, in Le Mans or WEC, World Rally Car, DTM, Formula 3, IndyCar racing, NASCAR racing. So a lot of stuff, all with internal combustion engines. And since a couple of years, we thought it would be not only good, it's going to be necessary to get engaged in e-motorsports. And we selected DS-Techeetah as a partner, and this is very important for us, that we are having a technical partnership. We are not interested in just doing sponsorship. So we want to get something out of our technical collaboration, which we can transfer to the road cars. This is our mission, basically. And so not so many has changed, because this was our aim as well, or is still our aim as well, for motor racing with internal combustion engines. Yeah?
So keyword sustainability, does it play a greater role than years ago?
Absolutely. In motor racing, sustainability is in the meantime playing a really important role. if you look to announcements that from 2030 on, CO2 emissions shall be at zero, for example, and not only for the race cars, as well for the spectators. So this is a huge, huge task to bring the people CO2 free to the tracks, to spend the weekend CO2 free. So a huge, huge challenge, and I think a necessary task we have to fulfill together. Beside the pure technical aspect, it's really a very important thing for our planet and for the future of our kids.
Yeah, absolutely. So in the beginning, we've already talked about the Formula E car here at the MAHLE booth. Mark, can you just introduce it to us a little bit?
Sure. So you can see it behind us over there. That's our, obviously, in the livery from this year, where we came third in the World Championship. So that was not as good as we've done in previous years when MAHLE first joined us. And we were dominant last year. But anyway, the competition is high. So it's an open wheeler, single seater. It's very similar to other single seaters, except it's got a very large battery in it behind the driver, electric motor in the rear. It's currently just rear wheel drive, but in the future, the generation threes of these vehicles are also going to have front wheel regeneration. So new technologies, more power, and other aspects. Very similar to other race cars with the halo for protecting the driver, which is obviously has come into play many times. We don't have as much downforce on these cars as other series, and that's because we also don't want the drag, which is not so good for electric cars. We want to be able to use to be more efficient. We have road tires, very similar to road tires. You can see the tires behind, which we only have three sets of tires per driver over a race weekend, although that varies slightly depending on which track we're at and whether there's a high wear. So that's very different from other racing series. We save a lot of CO2 from not transporting so many tyres around the world. So those tyres work in the dry and in the wet. So that's one of the big differences. And yeah, otherwise it's a race car at the end of the day. So it's an electric race car.
So I think there has been a very big progress concerning the cars in Formula E, Gen 1, Gen 2, can expect Gen 3. How do you think is the car going to look like?
So the biggest steps are actually from the technical side. So the regeneration from the front wheels will be able to take more energy into the battery. There'll be more total power. So this is 250 kilowatts peak. The new car will have 350 kilowatts peak plus 150 kilowatts from the front wheels under regeneration. Who knows, maybe we could even use those front wheels, the front wheel motors to also drive the car. That could be something that could happen in the future. And then going towards more things like fast charging and other things that are relevant to the road.
But beside the car, there has also been a very big progress in Formula E in general. Keyword, battery and switching the car.
Yes.
Can you just describe like the changing progress from season 1 to season 7?
Yeah, so in season 1 we had two cars per driver, as you say, and we had to swap in the middle of the race to be able to do the total race distance. Now we have one car for that same race distance, so it's come a long way in development over those years. We've got a lot faster, more power. We're approaching some of the other series in terms of total power now. So it's quite exciting, the big steps that are being made, and hopefully they mimic the things that are happening in the real world to keep that road race-to-road story relevant to everybody.
Let's talk a little bit about you as a team principal, because it's not only your job to control the race action on the track, you also have to coordinate the various partners. So let's look behind the scenes. What is it all about when you talk to Fred Türk, for example, at the phone?
So the thing about partnerships in motor racing is it's more knowledge, really. So obviously MAHLE will be very special at certain parts of engineering, and if we would have to have thousands of people if we didn't have partners, because it's better to have the expertise of all of our partners associated with us in order to go quicker, basically. So often it's this is what's going wrong on the racetrack, or this is the challenges we see happening in the future. These are some of the areas that we think maybe we're not the best at, and then we can ask MAHLE, what do you guys know about that thing? And they say, well, we tried this in a different series, and maybe we can bring that knowledge from somewhere else to make your cars faster. So it's a lot to do with problem solving, I suppose. What are the problems that we can see? What are the opportunities that you can see in designing the car in the future? And then getting partners involved in making that better for the future.
That sounds very good. So let's just switch the topic a little bit. In addition to electromobility, Fred, there are other possibilities for CO2 neutral motorsports. Keyword, synthetic fuels. and a partner of MAHLE, the Team 4 Motors. It's the team of the German musician Smudo, is using it to drive a Porsche at the Nürburgring Nordschleife, and also Formula One is planning to use it. So what is MAHLE contributing to this?
So the use of 100% renewable fuel. I'm not talking about synthetic fuel at the moment, because it's going more in the direction of biofuel, which makes perfectly sense. The 100% biofuel burning has a huge, huge impact on the combustion process itself. And therefore, components like pistons, valves, bearings need at least to get adjusted or developed completely new in order to make the biggest, to get the biggest efficiency and performance out of the renewable fuel. Because this is again the task. We are going racing and we want to be fastest on the track. And so the challenge is going on. But in the right direction with renewable and, as a consequence, CO2-free fuel.
So we just noticed analog to mobility, motorsport is also changing and transforming. Formula E and rally, quite many series. So, but hybrid drives and electric mobility have entered this scene, like simulators and esports. Where is that journey heading to? What do you think?
I think sustainability and simulation will play a much bigger role in the future as already today. But continuing inventing new things on the technical side, on the CO2 reduction, this will lead us again to edge of technology, independent if we are working on internal combustion engines or electrical drives. Yeah, and this is part of motorsports, that we are innovators and pushing to the limit and sometimes beyond the limit. Yeah,
that's right. So Mark, in the meantime, Formula E, like the Formula One, is an official world championship which is organized by the FIA. So, as in Formula One, also in Formula E, manufacturers go and come back or however. So, what's next to Formula E and DS-Techeetah?
So, what's next for us next year? Hopefully winning. Let's keep winning more races, winning the championship again. It's going to be fun next year, all the new tracks, places like Vancouver and South Africa, places like that will be fun to go to. So yeah, the future holds is more competition, people come and go, but it's still a sport and it's still exciting, and so we'll have new competitors, I'm sure, in the future.
Yeah, but they're really nice tracks in the next year's calendar. But what about the drivers? Are they going to stay, Jean-Éric Vergne and Antonio Felix da Costa?
Yeah, I mean, stability is one of the key elements of winning in motorsport. So, yeah, keeping stable and keeping the same drivers, same team, same partners is really a core aspect of winning. So, yeah, keeping everything the same is our goal.
So what do you think? What can we and what can the fans expect?
What can the fans expect? Well, there might be some new changes in the rules. We'll have to see with the FIA. I work on the sporting working group, which helps to look at the sporting rules. So there may be some changes for the future coming. There's, as you know, Alejandro is always dreaming up new ideas for like attack mode and other things that we do in Formula E. So I'm sure you'll expect to see something interesting as well in the race formats in the future.
And I've seen a very interesting quote of Jean-Éric Vergne yesterday on Instagram. He wrote, "Young kids are watching Formula E and they think electric vehicles are cool." I guess that's a statement you totally agree, right?
Yeah, I've got an electric car myself, so I enjoy them as well.
Perfect answer. That's just very perfect. So we've just talked about your phone calls before. Fred, let's just go back to that. How important are partnerships and how does that work? Can you just explain in easy words?
Yeah. In my view, a good relationship and the build-up of trust is a key element. And trust is a vital part because we are exchanging confidential information and data. And here, again, the intense exchange of data is the key to do a successful development, work together as a team, and only discussing, analyzing, looking what went wrong and taking appropriate counteractions leads to success. And here, trust again is vital.
Mark just said we can expect a lot of DS-Techeetah in the next season. Do you cheer for DS-Techeetah or do you have a favorite team? Or how does it look like?
Oh, that's a pretty simple answer. I'm a fan of our technical partners because I'm an engineer and it's my my passion.
Okay. So last question, because we need to look in the future. What will motorsports look like in about 10 years? What do you think?
I have no crystal ball, to be honest. I hope we will see exciting and thrilling races as we have right now. For sure, the formats may be different. The spectators may have a different view. But the most important thing is that we keep on pushing on technical side, on attracting people. And if we are going to achieve this, I'm more than happy.
That's a statement. Thank you very much, Fred Türk and Mark Preston, for the very interesting answers and the insights into performance and emotion and motorsport as an innovative accelerator. That was our MAHLE Mobility Talk for today. Thanks for watching. We're back tomorrow.